Hello again, everybody. This is whoa. What's happening to my stream? I'm getting a million zillion dropped frames. Okay, hang on. Stop this. Fix it. I'll be right back. All right, guys, we are back. Hopefully, this fixed my dropped frames issue. It looks like it did. Okay, all I did was lower the FPS down to 45. All right, so what we're going to be doing today is we're going to be going ahead and pretty much finalizing the base coat of my Grenadiers. I'm not done yet. I did a little bit of painting this afternoon. Actually, it was this evening before I turned the camera on, just so I could get a lot of it done ahead of time. Where's my mouse pointer? Hit that. And there we are. We are live. Okay, good deal. And so I left a couple of figures completely fresh so that I could do each of those steps to get us caught up to where I'm at, and then we'll continue on with future steps. Here we go. So I'm just going to put him back in the collection. Okay, so one of the paints that I was using the night before was Field Gray. Okay. There was, after going through these models, I had found one that has a Field Gray top. And I think it's this one. It is that one. And there was a spot between the bag and the entrenching tool that was missing some field gray. So I just remembered that I needed to touch that up before we continue on. Okay, I love me some Tamiya field gray. All right, so when you are picking out your field gray, as you already know, I've got a Vallejo field gray right here. Field gray, actually, I should go get it, but I've got another Vallejo. It's called German field gray or something like that, and it's actually brown. Because field gray was, or is, or has a lot of color variations, depending on when the dye was made, and understand that there were shortages of materials throughout all nations, actually, during the war. And sometimes the official manual might call for, let's say, field gray. The company making the uniforms might not use the same type of dye or a different consistency or something like that. So one field gray uniform is not always going to be the same as another field gray uniform. Specifically, over the years, they came out with different styles or different batches, and so don't sweat it. So if you've got a field gray that looks like this, use it. If you've got a field gray that looks like this, hell, use it. I'm going to actually use both of these. I'm going to use this as a highlight on that. After the dip process. Okay, so we got the field gray done. Now, I can actually probably put that in my little I've already used this color pile. Now what we're going to do is we're going to go on to no, I think it was boots, but that's okay. We'll go ahead and do this since I've got it in my hand. This is linen. I don't know if you can see that. Linen from Folkart. Okay, this is an awesome color. It's not white, right? It's not tan. It's like a brown, but super. That doesn't give it. That kind of does give it justice. It's kind of this color. I'm looking on my screen and it looks pretty accurate. That's what the color is. In my palette, that's the color it is. And it's super light. And you can see on some of these, that's the meal bag right there. That's the color I've been using. I also put it on their belt pouches. No, not then. Okay, that's the map case, right? And like on the submachine guns, how they have those long belt pouches, I put it on those. And the map cases. But here, let me put a drop back in there. I need less than a drop, because I've done them all except for one figure. So we'll put a wee bitty drop in there. Maybe a very small. Yeah, I mean, see that? A little bit of water. I mean, almost non-existent, right? Then I take my stirring stickage and I stir that up, because you don't want it to be too runny. And if you were watching last night, you're going to hear a lot of the same things being said tonight about paint in general. You don't want to add too much water, because what it does is it'll cause the paint to break down and separate, and it'll become thin. And you'll, when you're painting, you'll see it'll run everywhere and stuff like that. And you definitely don't want that. So I tend to do like 2 to 4 parts paint and then only 1 part of water, so it stays kind of nice and thick. And luckily, folk art almost never breaks down. I mean, I've been painting with it for a while, and I don't struggle with it at all. Okay, so here we go. Let's crank this thing out. I'm using a zero on my brush. Easy. And if you remember, I paint up to the edge of the item, whatever the item is, and I tend to use a little bit of, I leave a little bit of black where the item would be touching the other item. Like where it touches his tunic, I try not to paint it all the way to the edge. I give it a little bit microscopic black line right there. And what that does is it draws the color out and makes it pop. And remember, you know, your models, even though I might be rushing and painting these super fast, it might appear that I'm painting these super fast on the stream. I think that's because I don't want to have you guys sit here and watch me paint for hours and hours, which is what's actually happening, because I've been painting for, this is what, episode 5? Yeah. So I've been working on these guys for 5 days straight. Constructing, well, first one was a review. That was actually just a whole day of just doing a review. And then, yep, there, that looks good. Boom, mealy bag. Okay. Let's take a look. Did I do the mealy bag on this one? I did, but if you notice, it's kind of, the black's kind of shining through, and that's okay, because I'm going to wash these guys with a, And why are these guys that way? Okay. I think they're supposed to be like that. Okay. I'm going to wash them with that dip, and when I do that, it's going to really colorize these guys. But if you find any raised areas that you'd like to have that color, go ahead and make sure you color the raised areas. That way, when you dip it, it won't overwhelm your color, causing it to like disappear. You only want your color, to be highlighted or actually washed. You don't want it to be drowned out. So if I see some raised areas that don't look like they have enough paint, I'll go back and touched it up. But that's also, again, once we're done washing it, and I go back and I highlight all my areas, when you highlight, you hit all the high areas anyway. Okay, so see, already done with the linen. You know what? I'm going to start a little box like this. You can't see it, but I'm going to start a box over here with the paints that I don't plan to go back to until after the dip. So, that color, I'm not going to go back to it until after the dip. The field gray highlight, I'm not going to touch this until after the dip. Linen, it's pretty much done, right? It's all the mealy bags and all the figures, done. Next step. Okay, they're boots. They're boots. Different units had different colored boots. Black, you can't say that all units' boots were black. I've done a lot of research, and a lot of times they would not be black. They would not be dyed. They would just be the raw leather. Why? Shortages. And also, it's later in the war, the late war units tended to favor the brown boots. So, I went with real brown. It's real. It's not fake. It's real brown. Okay. So, we're going to... And you can see when real brown dries... It dries pretty dark, okay? That's almost black, okay? So, it's like super dark. And you know what? That's perfect for the boots. That way, also, they've been out in the field, you know? They've gotten a little dirt on their boots, you know? They got to wash their feet or their... They don't have any place to wash their shoes, so... They're going to have a little bit of brown to them. I know that there are some painters out there that will take... They'll paint the boots black, and then they will kind of highlight or dry brush a brown to kind of get that mixed effect, which that's totally 100% okay too. It's whatever you feel comfortable with, but remember, do a little research. Look at some historical pictures, maybe some photographs, and I don't mean the black and white ones because that doesn't help you at all. You know, so look at some color photos. Go to some Osprey books. You know, they've done a lot of research. They get paid to make those books, specifically with all the info. Okay, so now we're gonna paint these boots. Now I need to explain the way these pants work, the way the pants and the boots interact, because that's going to impact how you paint the boots. The boot bottoms, of course. I mean, yeah. No brainer, right? And then the boot sides only go up till where the... there's this thing called an ankler. It's kind of like a gaiter, but it wraps around the ankle, right? And only the ankle. If you know anything about gaiters, gaiters actually wrap around the boot and under the foot, right between the heel and the ball of the foot. There's usually a strap that goes under the boot. The Germans don't have that type of gaiter. But I guess you could call them a gaiter. But those are a different color than both the pants and the boot. So just paint the boot up to the gaiter, and then when we're painting the pants, you just paint it down to the gaiter. So be sure to leave the gaiter. It doesn't really matter. And that's another thing. You can cover the gaiters if you want, and then just go back and paint the gaiter, right? Because that's a step after the brown, so it doesn't matter, because the brown will just be underneath whatever paint you put on the gaiters. Okay, that's how some of the pants work. Some other pants, and I am specifically talking about these Grenadiers, some of the other pants have, as part of the pants themselves, have kind of like a drawstring, kind of like modern pants. Modern military pants have drawstrings, Okay, and if it does, you can tell the way the models are modeled. The pant comes down, and then there's like this. Let me see if I can find one. Yeah, this one. You see how, I don't know if you can, if I got this on focus or if you can see it, but at the bottom of the pant, right above the brown, as part of the pant, you see all these little vertical lines. It's almost like it's elastic. And I can't get too close because then it'll start getting all blurry and stuff, so. Yeah, I don't know. You might not be able to see that on that camera. But either way, those are still the off color. So those are going to be khaki. Okay, so I've painted all the boots, right? Everybody's got their boots done. Everybody's got their bags done. Okay, we're making progress. Okay, the next color is, I'm stepping out of my wheelhouse here, Sienna, right, from Model Master. It's a very reddish brown. You can use red brown too. I mean, this is not red brown, but Vallejo makes a color called red brown. They also, there's another company out there, I think it's a P3. They make a color that's really kind of a reddish brown. But I'm going with a red brown. And I'm going to use it for the canteen covers. Okay, so you've got this canteen. Let's try not to spill that. But yeah, you got this little canteen right there that has a, this bottom portion of it is a fur. It's a fuzzy cover that you wet down. It keeps your water in the canteen cool in a summer day. Yeah, and it's actually a brown, and it's usually really fuzzy. Not super fuzzy, but it does have some fuzz to it, I should say. Because it's like a fur. Okay, and then you paint it up to the canteen cup. Make sure you don't paint the canteen cup, just the bottom part of the canteen. Because if you take the canteen cup off, and there would be like a little nozzle, little metal screw on top that you would take off. Okay. Okay, have I done all of them? Nope, wait, yeah, didn't do this guy either, so let's get this guy done. He's got all, every, 100% of these guys have canteen cups, or canteen, just canteens, water canteens. There should not be any variation between nations or time frames. These things were pretty much all exactly the same. Okay, now, I also, I'm just going to kind of pull it out and show you. Like, I've also done the wood on the machine gun the same color. Okay. What else have I done in that color? Nothing. Okay. You could use the rifle stocks, that same color, or maybe even the assault rifles. Maybe the stocks of the assault rifles. I'm thinking I want to do that in that color, but nope. Maybe just for contrast, you know. It's really just for contrast. It's going to be washed anyway, so. Okay, that's pretty much done. Put that off to the side. Clean my brush off. Oh, we're flying through it. Now, guess what? I've already done. That's the color. Those are the colors that I did earlier today. So, that's why I think you think we're flying when we're really not. All right. Next color. Next color. Where is it? There it is. Black green. Black green from Poly Shade. Right. Okay. This is the color of the helmets. It's not German gray. A lot of people will paint their German helmets gray. Well, they're not gray. They are a really super dark green. So go with a black green. Okay, so here we go. Let's see if these guys on the end. Also, not just helmets, but what's the word? The gas mask carrier is also in the dark green. Black green, actually, not just dark green. Dark green is not dark enough. Okay, I've already done his helmet. I've already done his helmet in the green. You can kind of see it against the white there. And I've already done his pack. Not his pack, his canteen. His pack. I'm jumping all over the place. Gas mask. Okay, I've already done his gas mask. There are some of these guys that have gas mask carriers, but they have their poncho is wrapped around the gas mask carrier. So you got to kind of hit on the ends, the gas. And because anybody with a camouflage cover on their helmet, of course I didn't paint it. Because I'm going to paint those camouflage. I only painted the solid metal helmets and the gas mask carriers. Those are the only things. Oh, wait, that's not true. There's one additional thing I paint that color, and that is the mess kit. So if you see a mess kit on their back, okay, that's also painted that color. All right. That is that color. Because I've already done all of them with that color as well. I don't know if you can see any of those. You can kind of see, like, he's got it I think that's all you can see. Maybe that guy's got it as well. Yeah, so there's only like five of them with those type of helmets. Because of the kit, it pretty much gives you 11 different heads, which on five sprues is 55, but 11 different heads. One of them is this head, one of them is this head, and then one of them doesn't have a camouflage cover. So out of all five sprues, you only get five without camouflage covers. But then again, remember, this is late war grenadiers and not early war grenadiers. The early war grenadiers, they would be a lot easier to paint. They would just have jack boots and... Whoops, sorry. They would just have jack boots and everything would be feel great. Okay, so what are we going to do now? We're going to paint the Panzerfausts. Okay. Don't freak out. Boom. Okay. I'm using... It's almost a golden color, right? It's a golden ochre, right? It's an ochre color, and it's super, super golden. But remember, when I go back in, I'm going to dip this with brown. It's going to darken this, okay? But I want it to be super bright. I want the Panzerfaust to kind of really, really stand out. Okay, on my palette, what I'm doing now is... You can see the spot right here. I'm basically just pushing the aluminum foil down so that it's a nice, smooth bin so that when I'm stirring, I don't hit the sides of the aluminum foil and all that stuff. You know, get caught and splatter paint everywhere. Okay, so this is one of the newer colors that I just got from Hobby Lobby maybe a week ago. So I haven't used it very much, but I am pretty excited about this color, so... And it looks kind of like mustard, right? And guess what? Mustard is the official, is the correct color. If you can find something that says mustard on it, put that on your sandwich. Okay. I think mustard is actually the official color name that this is supposed to be. But this is golden ochre there is an ochre in the P3 line. I think it's called something ochre. I can't remember what it's called. Yellow ochre? Maybe it's called yellow ochre or something. No, it's called, I don't know, but it is an ochre. And it's named after one of the nations, probably, like Crick's ochre or something. But it is not this bright. It's like this, but a little bit darker. And I considered using it, but then I thought about the dip process. And I said, you know what? I'm going to dip this, and it's going to automatically be dark. And then if for whatever reason it doesn't get as dark as I want it to, I know it will. It's going to be super dark. I can always change it. I can always go back later and paint it. Okay, now this is only for the Panzerfausts, right? So we're just going to start with Panzerfaust number one and go down the line. And what is it? The whole thing, 100% coverage. Ooh, that's thin. Maybe I put too much water in there or something. See how that's super thin? I don't like that. Yeah, that's too thin. Okay. That is way too thin. Maybe I didn't. Okay. I didn't think I put too much water in this thing. Yellows, just heads up, any yellow that you use, even Citadel yellow or Vallejo yellow, any yellows that you use on models almost always come out super thin like that. Almost always. And so what that usually means is you got to put a super light coat on and then let it dry and then go back and put another super light coat. But just for speed, I don't want to do that. I want 100% coverage. Okay, so we're mixing another drop into this with no additional water. So just basically thickening it up a little bit. Hopefully that's what I'm doing. And it goes on the aluminum foil really good. Goes on the paper towel really good. Okay. I didn't put it in there. I'm just moving around this mount that's already on here. Okay, I'm going to set number one off to the side a little bit. Let that dry up a little bit. Okay, this is my new concoction. Let's see how it works. Much better. Yes. Yes, much better. Notice how I'm leaving a little black line between the hand and the actual rocket grenade. Now I'm covering up any details. There's like a line that goes around, and there's like a hollow charge in the front. It doesn't matter. Cover it. Because guess what? When you go back in and dip this thing, that dip is going to bring out all those details that you covered up. Yeah, dip is like magic. I'm actually surprised I've been painting for so long. Well, I've been dipping for probably 10 years, but before that, I wasn't dipping. And I don't. And Army Painter just came out with their paint line, and they've got dips. And that was one of the big selling points of Army Painter is, oh wow, they got like dips. Man, I've been dipping for 10 years. I've been using. What's it called? Min Wax. I've been using Min Wax for years. Okay, notice how I had to spend a little bit of concentration on that little spot right there. Because I want to paint it, but I don't want to get it on my hands. And I still want to leave a little bit of a black area between the hand and the color. Almost like when you're reading a comic book and you're looking at the guys that are drawn on the comic book. They've got black lines surrounding them and then the color is on the inside, right? Well, basically that's exactly what I'm doing with all my colors on my model. I'm giving it that black comic book outline. Not because I want my figures to look cartoony, but because I want the colors to be really standout-ish. I want them to really pop. And it'll make it look like you're a professional painter. They'll say, "Oh my God, your models look so cool. What do you do?" And you'll be giggling inside, saying, "You know, I just avoid having the paints touch each other. I let my black primer shine through." Now you can't do that if you prime gray. Like you'll see a lot of guys out there priming their guys gray. Okay, the reason why they do that. Okay, gray is a neutral color. And all paints, metals, yellows, reds, and all of your military camouflages will go on top of gray. The problem with gray is you can't utilize the fact that it's black to cheat. At that point, if you're using gray, and see how the black, I don't know if you can kind of see that on the camera. See how the black draws the shape of your Panzerfaust away from the hands and the sleeves? See, that's exactly why you do that. Okay, so they can't do what I just did. To be able to do what I just did, and most painters will want to do something like that, they have to go back in with an additional step, and they use inks. They usually use black ink on a super fine tip pen, and then they draw those lines in, which I'm kind of okay with drawing those lines in. I'm going to push this up a little bit so that it reminds me that I've got somebody watching. Okay. So where I need to put the model so you can see what I'm doing. I also bumped the camera. That might have moved where the view was. There we go. You don't want the black line to be so big that it becomes dominant. But you do want it to be there. So just experiment. Just paint your models a few times and take one model at a time and paint it until you see exactly how big see how big the black line should be. And then you'll basically have experience and you'll be able to do that on every model going forward. Do it on your Macedonians. Do it on your British. Do it on your Romans. Do it on your U.S. paratroopers. Oh, wait. Am I talking to myself? I'm talking to myself. If you missed last night's video, I just want to say this. I pretty much made a decision. I'm going to go ahead and go to 20/28. I'm making the plunge. I just said, fuck it. I'm going 28s. I'm not going to do 20s anymore. I have a bunch of 20s, but I mean, I can hold on to them or I can get rid of them. It doesn't matter. I am now 100% committed to 28s, and I think I'm going to do 28s for all my games. I'm just going to give up on all other scales and just stay with 28s for everything. World War II. Napoleonics. Napoleonics. Ancients. Now, my naval stuff, I'm not going to do in 28 millimeter. But yeah, World War II, definitely. Ancients, definitely. There seems to be a little bitty piece there. I want to straighten that out. There we go. American War of Independence. I've already got a bunch of 28s. Got some Perry miniatures. And those are really good, too. I'm going to have to give Perry miniatures a try in their World War II just to kind of see what they look like. But I bet you, if they look anything like my American War of Independence figures, then they're going to look good. Didn't Perry used to work for Games Workshop as well as Rick Priestley? Maybe way back in the day or something. I'm taking my time on these, okay? Just, I'm not like flying through. And one of the reasons is I don't want to accidentally paint something that I'm not supposed to paint. Trying to give it a black line around everything so that it will, you know, so it'll look good. Now, I don't really need to worry about that so much because I'm going to be dipping it and it's going to fill in the gaps between the items and the adjacent items. But the problem with that is they're not a problem per se, as doing it this way and that way just makes it stand out even that much more. Some of these are going to be easier than others, like the ones that are just holding them in their hands, or the ones that are, the ones holding them in their hands should be a lot easier. And I'm kind of curious, now that I'm looking at it, why those Panzerfausts look different than this Panzerfaust. Because this one's got like a pointed tip, right? It's a different type of shape charge, probably. Did Panzerfausts go through... I know they did, now that I think about it. They did go through generations. They had a Panzerfaust 100 and a Panzerfaust 60, didn't they? I think they did. I think one was called a 60 and one was called a 100. And I think all that really represented was its effective range. It's like the 60 had an effective range of, guess what, 60 meters. And the Panzerfaust 100, I think it had a effective range of 100 meters. I think. But I could be wrong. I'm going off of like 20-year-old memory. I should probably look that up. If you're watching this live, I'm not watching my live stream. Okay, so... if you're chatting with me or commenting, I might or might not ever see that because I'm not looking up at the live stream. I'm painting. And if you expect a response, then I'm sorry. I apologize for that. I know I like to engage my audience, but please bear with me, okay? I'm in the middle of painting. Sorry. Now, when I switch colors and I go to another color, I'll glance up at the chat and see if I can't answer any questions you might have or anything like that. But it'll be between colors. Okay. Now, unfortunately, even though I'm going to dip tonight, I am going to dip tonight. I am going to continue this process no matter what, failing everything. until I get to the point where I need to dip. And then I'm going to dip these guys. Now the problem with that is they're going to look like, it's going to look like a mess. It's these models are going to look like they've been dropped in a puddle of mud or something. And you won't be able to see the results until the following day. Now luckily I am off tomorrow. And so I plan to work on these in the afternoon tomorrow. So if you are interested in watching me finish these guys, I'm going to be spending some time in the afternoon tomorrow finishing these guys. So tomorrow night, I might already be finished. Maybe. Just depends on how everything dries and everything. That one looks pretty good. Ah, yikes. I know you guys, if you're watching this and you've been following this whole enterprise here, I know you're excited for me to get to the camouflage of the smocks, because that's really the most complicated, I guess is what you could say, part of the painting process. But this ain't rocket science. This isn't complicated. All you gotta do is just do it. And just do it right. And if you don't, no big deal. Just go back and repaint it. Okay, I thought about this too when I was painting earlier today when I was off camera. I said, okay, I'm going to paint their eyes. Right? I'm going to really go to town on these 28mm models. I know how to paint eyes, and I know how to make them look extremely good. I'm going to do it. But I'm not going to give you a tutorial on how to do it. I know, it's like, oh man. Because this is what my thought process was. Eyes deserve their very own tutorial. They deserve their own video. And my eye process to put eyes on models at this scale, or really any scale, I don't think I've seen very many other people paint that way. And they come out looking like realistic. So be sure to catch my eye tutorial whenever I get around to making that. And that'll probably be when I paint their eyes. Which I don't think I'm going to paint their eyes until after they're finished. It'll be like one of those post-production kind of things. I don't know. Maybe, I don't know when I'm going to paint their eyes. Because I'm thinking painting their eyes. I don't want to paint their eyes before I dip it. Because when I dip it, then it's going to look like they're all bloodshot eyes. It just means they're sleepy, but still, I don't want to do that. Not to my veteran German grenadiers. So, and as you already know as well, I'm kind of a campaign coordinator. So, like a referee. I like running campaigns and running the games and, you know, kind of be the guy in the background, you know, organizing the campaign. And I like inviting people that have never played before or are thinking about playing and stuff like that. So what that usually means is, and this is unfortunate for me, but it is kind of where I get a lot of my enjoyment. I have to have more than one army. I have to have both sides. Because I'll say, hey, Cody, you want to come check out some bolt action? And he'll say, sure, let's check it out. And he'll come and he'll sit down and he'll play, but he won't have any figures. He won't have the rule book. He won't know what he's doing. So I have to have the Germans. I have to have the Americans. I have to have all the terrain. I have to have all the dice, you know? So, damn, right? And if I run any kind of campaign or anything, I'm not going tournament style. Like, I've got a scenario book called, I've got a bunch of scenario books, and they're made by skirmish campaigns. Well, they're not specifically designed to be played using points. Those campaigns say, you have a squad of five Germans. Two of them have MP40s. One of them has a KR, an assault rifle. One of them has an MG42. And you don't get to choose. It's like, this is what you have, right? And so when I go and I look through these scenario books, and I look at all the different scenarios that they have listed, if I want to play one of these, I have to have all the figures. So, and the figures for one game are not the same for figures from another game. A lot of times they are. Like a German rifleman is pretty much a German rifleman, right? And a German machine gunner is pretty much a German machine gunner. But sometimes it says you need a medic. Okay, well, guess what? I don't have a German medic. So what am I going to do? I have to get a German medic. And then on the next game, it'll say, you have a flamethrower guy. Well, guess what? I don't have a flamethrower guy. So that means I got to get a flamethrower guy. So pretty much, it's my predicament is, and guess what? I embrace this. I embrace the suck. My predicament is, I have to have a little bit of everything. Sometimes a lot of everything. That's why I don't run Russian campaigns. Or, yeah, because I would have to have so many models on the table, it would be, I'd go bankrupt. Or I'd have to have so many models in my collection, maybe not on the table. That's another thing. Even if you go point-wise, the Russian army is not really a good army for dollars because you got to buy extra squads because they get free squads. You got to buy lots of tanks because their points are so cheap. And just putting this out there too, if you're curious, this squad, this platoon actually of 30 Germans costs the same as one tank. Yeah. Maybe the tank's a little less, like $25 instead of 30. And if you're lucky, you can shop on eBay and buy tanks from Mr. Everything and get them cheap. That's me. Okay. Okay, he's got his Panzerfaust. Panzerfaust. There should be three per squad. Yep, I'm only on, just starting the third row. Here we go. And this guy should, look at that. It's just laying on his back. You can't even see that. See, there's no contrast on black. But, yeah, it's just laying on his back. So, shouldn't be too hard. Now, this is something that I kind of thought about. I almost regret doing this, and that's painting all the accessories before I do the camouflage. I might have, probably should have, definitely should have done the camouflage first. And then went back and painted all these accessories. But, fuck it. saving the camouflage for last. Screw it. And I'll just avoid all these items and leaving the black line. Hey, wait, what? That's what you're supposed to do. Golden ochre, man. Golden ochre. Okay. Another painting technique is I take my hands and I firmly place them on the table. Both of them. The one with the brush. And I tend to use my pinkies as guide. And you might not see this, but like when I'm painting, this pinky's out as a stabilizer. So when I'm painting, I'm holding the model still using my hand touching. And I use my other hand, the ball of my palm is on the table, but my pinky's out kind of keeping me from jiggling. If you painted up in the air like this, both your hand moves and the model moves, so it double compounds the movement. And then if you drink a lot of coffee like I do, that even makes it worse. So, as you see, my hands are on the table because the table shouldn't be moving unless you've had a little bit of alcohol. Then you probably shouldn't be painting. Ah, there we go. The top of it needs to be painted. I was like, wasn't there a spot that needed to be painted? And then I got to talking. My brain doesn't work that way. It's hard for me to think about painting and talk at the same time. There's a guy at work, Mike. Not Mike... Not Geek Squad Mike, but Computer Mike. Computer Mike, you know, asked me, hey, how you doing? You know, whatever. You know, like you do. And I said, oh, you know, I've been making these videos. And then we started a little conversation about the painting tutorials and stuff like that. And, you know, he asked a few questions and I responded. And then in my response, he made me realize something because I said it out loud. These videos are slowing me down. I think I would have these guys all finished already if I didn't have to wait for me to talk, me to reply, me to set up the camera, set up the stream, set up the sound, you know, get the paint organized, get the camera focused in the right spot. You know, there's a little bit of extra effort other than just sitting down and painting that I have to do for the stream. And I was thinking, I told him, I said, you know what, I probably could have these done a lot faster if I wasn't talking about it. Because first of all, my brain doesn't work that way. My brain can't talk and type at the same time. I talk or I'll paint. Right now you hear me talking and painting, but I'm not really thinking about it. I'm just going. And I'm probably rambling too, so... And I'm not reading chat. Tonight I made a conscious decision to kind of only look at the chat between colors, like when I'm shaking the bottles, and not between every brush stroke like I did last night. I don't have the right glasses to see my screen. The glasses I'm wearing are super magnified. They're like 4.0s. It's almost like I'm wearing magnifying glasses on my eyes. When I was younger, there was professional painters that mentored me, and they said, use one of those desk magnifiers, you know, that you have like on a boom that has a light, so you can like hold it over your model and you can turn the light on. I tried that. I had a magnifier, and I couldn't use it because I would think that my brush was going this far, you know, but on the model it was going because of the magnification. And so I couldn't train my, I don't know, it was just, it's a disability. I couldn't train myself to compensate for that. It was just way too much. But these glasses, these are basically all they are reading glasses. And they magnify everything enough for me to not do that, if that makes sense. I recommend it, even if you don't have bad eyesight, even if your eyesight's 20/20, I still recommend getting some readers. Find some readers that you can get a model this close to your face, and then it magnifies it so that when you're doing your painting, you know, there's nothing wrong with wearing glasses while you're painting. Now, if your eyes start to hurt or they start to strain, then either your glasses are too strong or you've just been doing it so long that your eyes are... Because the focus of your eyes is going to be thrown off by wearing these glasses. So you have to kind of take your glasses off and rub your eyes and go sit and play computer games or something for a little while. Let your eyes relax and then you come back to it. Man, I can't believe I've actually given some really good advice tonight. Some stuff's just been coming to me, you know? I'm painting and... Ooh, that didn't look good. We'll fix that. There we go. Done. Fixed. Some of the field gray was on his Panzerfaust. No big deal. Remember, I don't know if you heard this, but there is a technique to paint from the outside layer all the way down to the inside layer. That's kind of what I'm doing with the accessories. But my preferred technique is to paint from the skin outwards. I think it's faster. It might not be as clean. It might not be as... I don't know. It might not be as... detailed, but it allows you to make mistakes and then cover it up with the next layer. So like what I just did here, field gray, I painted it on the jacket, but I got a little bit on the Panzerfaust. It's okay, because guess what? I came back later, painted the Panzerfaust, covered up all those mistakes. Same thing with the flesh. When you're painting faces and hands and stuff, it doesn't matter where you slap that paint. You could paint the whole figure flesh color. Actually, you don't want to do that, but because then you're getting rid of that whole black process that you deliberately primed your guys black specifically so that you could have black lines. But yeah, you could paint the flesh, and if it gets on the collar, no big deal, because you're getting ready to go paint the collar. If it gets on the helmet, don't worry about it. You're going to paint the helmet later. So flesh should actually be one of the fastest colors that you paint, and because all you're doing is just slapping it on. You're hardly even keeping track of where you're putting it. And if you are, then you're just being too anal. Just slap it on, because your other colors are going to cover any mistakes. And then same thing with the field gray. Just slap it on. Just don't hit your flesh. Because follow-up colors are going to fix whatever mistakes from areas that you go into. But if you're trying to do the black lining technique, then when you get to a spot that has a different color, like from the Field Grey to the Panzerfaust, then you should take a few extra seconds not to let them touch. Leave a little black line in between. Okay, so that was... Now I'm going to go back to the very first Panzerfaust number one. That's dry. It was... That was the one that was all too watery. Also, when you're painting a war model, Romans, Germans, 40K, anything that's a wargaming model, we're talking about mistakes or paint coverage and stuff like that. If you paint a model and you forget a certain spot and there's, or if the paint was thin, so thin that the black undercoat is shining through, that's okay. Because guess what? That soldier, that model that you're painting, he's been fighting. He's been out in the field. He's his armor, if he's a Marine, or his field gray uniform, or his sword, it's not always going to look perfect and pristine like it's brand new. So don't try to paint your models as if they're brand new. These guys didn't come from just straight from basic training. Right? So they should have a little bit of this imperfections all over the place. If there is imperfections all over the place, it gives your model character. It brings it to life. Now, do you want to have too many imperfections? Of course not. You don't want to just like slap paint all over the place. But if you notice that, like, you paint, okay, like just what I just did, right? I paint, but there's this, I don't know, is it in focus? I don't even know, I gotta lean forward. There you go, you might be able to see it like that. See how that black is shining through the yellow right there? I could leave it like that and just go with it. I'm not going to, but I could, because guess what? Maybe the paint rubbed off while this guy's been out and fighting a war. That will only work, that whole little tip will only work if you prime black. I'm telling you, man, black base coat, prime base coat is your friend. It is seriously, seriously your friend. Okay, see how the hands, there's black, sleeves, black. Pouches, black in between them. Yeah, I know. Once you go black primer, you never go back to white. That's what that saying means. You know, when you go black, you don't go back. That's what it means. Oh my gosh. Sorry, I had to say that. Okay, so that is... Bada bing, bada bang. Okay, that is the... Bop. Gold. Whoop, whoop, beep, beep. On camera. Golden ochre. Alright, put that off to the side. Oh my gosh, look at the chat! The chat's exploding! Okay. Sorry guys, I just now looked up at the chat. Okay, so, and it's off my screen. I gotta scroll. Yes, Gator. I think that's exactly how you spell it. It might even be spelled with an ER. You know what? Give me a second. I've got this. I have a screen right in front of me, and it says, "Boom." No, where? Boom. Boom. Boots. Water bottles. Boom. black ink, dry brush. See, I got some notes here. Hang on. Gaiters. I don't know if that helps. Yes, Panzerfaust, correct. I'm working my way down three fast. He just finished the canteen painting. Yeah, maybe added armor piercing add-on. Yeah, maybe. I'm not sure. Because once it's fired, that big bulb in the front is actually the projectile, so it should either be there or not be there, not the little pointy thing. So I might have to look. Might have to do some research on that. Okay. Yeah, give me the ice secret exactly. That's right, around everything. Exactly. Yeah, but I bet you don't have any bolt action dice. Okay, there's a question. Okay, here's a question. If you do look at chat, have you ever made SS elite troops, or do you just use core German units?
Okay. Give me 2 seconds. I'm kind of letting that dry a little bit, so I might as well go.
Way over here.
Oh, what the? Okay. I went and grabbed my 20mm stuff. The stuff I'm getting away from. I'm trying to focus. Personally, my eyes aren't focused. That's a problem. Scooch up here a little bit so I can see what's going on. There we go.
That's the P-Dot camouflage on some SS, a machine gun team for the SS.
That's just one of many.
It's a dude that's got like a camouflage outfit or whatever. He's SS as well. Just like an individual rifleman with the P-Dot camouflage.
So, yes, I also have
some Fallschirmjägers.
But the problem with those guys are they're just a little bit too small for people to see them on the table. You know? And all the tournaments that I've kind of observed are all done in 28mm. So I missed the boat by having all these 20s from way back when. Okay, let me get to the next caller so we don't lose anything. Thanks, Tigger Man. Appreciate it. Okay, so where are we going? We're going to go with... I'm kind of looking at my model, trying to decide. I think... Therefore, I am. No. Super fast. This is something that won't be any problem at all. I'm going to pull out this antique white. Okay? It's for their teeth. No, actually, this is antique white. I'm going to put it down for their maps. There's two guys that have a map out, and they're the only two. And so... Oh, no. I forgot something. Okay. No problem. I can back up. We're going to back up. I'm going back to the yellow ochre, or golden ochre, actually. And luckily, I still have it right here, and I still have quite a bit mixed up. The machine gunners, or the assistant gunners, they're ammo boxes. They also need to be that golden ochre. Sorry. I'm seeing an issue here. I think I'm gonna have to do two coats on this, even with I hate the yellow having to do two coats kind of thing. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put my base coat on. I'll let it dry for just a few minutes while I do something else and then come back and finish these. But the ammo cans need to be the yellow ochre as well. I thought about using like a wood color because that's kind of what it's going to wind up being. But it's going to look like that after I get it. After I do the dip. Okay, he doesn't have one. There should only be like five of these arms, and I don't think I used all of them. I think I might have only used four of them. And I did find my brass. I did pull my brass out and put it in the paint tray there that I'm going to be using. Because I prep ahead of time. I pick the paint out knowing what colors I need. I do that ahead of time. So that while I'm painting, I don't... I don't have to go dig for paints. I already have them all prepared. But that's okay. That's only the base coat. I had painted these the black green, because it's metal. But then I realized, wait, it's not supposed to be black green. It's supposed to be yeller. Old yeller. Oh, remember I said I painted the boots real brown? Looking at this model right here, it reminded me. I also painted the rifle slings real brown as well. So, that rifle sling is actually real brown as well.
So having said that I am going to be switching to 28s, guess what? I'm probably not going to be selling these. I don't know. I don't want to do all this work and then just turn around and sell it. But if I don't sell this, then what I'm going to do is go ahead and just dump my 20 millimeter. I'm just going to sell them the SS you just saw. Now, these models can be painted as SS. The box says that they're suitable for SS as well as your standard Wehrmacht. But I'm just not painting them as SS because that's a lot of points in the game. And I was planning on selling them, so I didn't want to put all that effort into it and put like a PDOT camouflage on these guys. I wanted to paint something that was more versatile or more, more widely needed by players that might actually be buying, you know? So I didn't go SS, because that's kind of a limited crowd. Only the people that have SS armies are going to use an SS model and all that jazz. So, and most people that play Germans don't play SS because of the cost of the points for the army when you build it. They usually just go with veterans, which you can have a veteran without it being SS. They might be going with veterans because they have the same abilities as the SS without the hassle of having to paint the SS camouflage. So they're basically min-maxers in a way. And I went over a whole topic about that last night, about how there are players out there that if they could get away with not painting their models, they would just play with non-painted models. Just because they're playing the game and they could care less about what a German soldier looks like or what his colors are or why he wore a certain type of uniform or, you know, he doesn't care about that. He just wants to blow up his opponent with a bunch of dice rolls. And that's not me. I am not that kind of a gamer. I am more of a, I want to know the history behind the troops. I want to know, that's one reason why I haven't got into the Gates of Antares yet, because I don't know the history of any of that game. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to do that white, and then we'll come back to the yellow and touch that up just to fix the watery look that it has. Yeah, but you don't have bolt action dice. I'll say it again. Oh my God. This is just the bolt action dice. Boom. It's excited, of course, but you don't have fire, rally, down, ambush, advance. American and German. Yeah. Yeah, you don't have that, sucker. Okay. And guess what? I also have these other dice. Three-sided dice. Do you have a three-sided die? Hey. Do you have a averaging dice? I've got those. Okay. Oh, white. Yep, I'm going to do white. It's really not white. It's like an antique. I'm doing that as the map paper.
And why didn't I just use white? I could use just white because it doesn't matter because I'm, guess what? I'm going to be dipping it and it's going to darken everything and turn it into dirt color. But I didn't want it to be too dark. I mean, I didn't, yeah, I don't know. I had it available, so what the hell, I'll use it. Stirring my water and my antique white. Antique white, I guess, could be really good for bones, too, like if you were doing skeletons. It's lighter than, what's that color that Citadel used to make? Bleached bone, yeah, it's lighter than that. But it's basically on the same vein of being kind of a ivory, weird-looking color. Okay. Now, there should only be a couple of guys that have maps that need assistance. And when I get to... And lines on this would be really good, because that could be roads and hills and stuff. I do plan to later go on and draw some, like, designs and squiggles and stuff like that on the map to make it look like it's actually a map and not just a piece of blank paper. Because it could be just a piece of blank paper. You know what? I probably should use that golden ochre on his binoculars because German binoculars were golden colored. You know what? I think I'm going to do that. When I go to fix the ammo cans, I'm going to paint his binoculars golden ochre. And there's like two guys with binoculars. Nope, one. Okay, this is the only pair of binoculars I got out. That'll be easy. Yep, that looks pretty good. And this other map is all up in this guy's face. It's like, it's almost like he's trying to read it and run at the same time. He's on the move reading his map. He's like, is this the right house? Is this the right house? What's the address here? So what that means is, I do have a bunch of 28mm buildings and stuff like that for Dungeons & Dragons. Those could be used for bolt action. Some of them can be, because they're just basically medieval-looking houses and stuff. But I don't think they're right. I need to get in and make some of my own. That's what I'm thinking. Okay, that white's done. So let's do the binos real quick. Binos are going to be the golden color. And then I'm going to go do a little touch up on those ammo cans. You know, you would think modern binoculars are like OD green, but that's US. And that's also modern. German binoculars, not so much. I've got a couple of different photos from a couple of different sources, and they were golden. Wonder if they're Bushnells. I mean, I don't even know.
And then once I go in to highlight the binoculars, I will take a little bit of silver and put that on the tip of the binocular to kind of give it a like a shiny glass look. Okay, so those binoculars are pretty much done. Woo, he went flying. Let's go back to the ammo pouches. See, because I don't like that look. We're going to fix that with a second coat. And again, they've been in the field. They've been at war. It's okay to have a little bit of that. Just not too much of it. It's okay to have a little bit of worn ammo cans or whatever. I'm dabbling. I'm not stroking. I'm dabbling right now to keep the stroke, to keep it from the stroke lines, the brush causing the stroke lines. If you dabble, you won't get those stroke lines. Is it dabble or dapple with a P? Or is it a B? I think it's dapple with a P. I don't know. English is not my primary language. I speak American. Yeah, that looks good. Okay. That one looks good. Moving on to the next one. That one actually already looks pretty good. It just has a couple of spots that needs to be fixed. Stroke. Yep, there we go. Looks good. Stroke. The paint's getting thicker, too. That's probably what is causing this. Yeah, this gold is thickening up. It's like the water that I added is drying up. I guess I could always add more water, but I don't want it to be too thin at that point. You know, and then I fuck it up. So back to dappling. Looking good. We're getting there. These guys are starting to come together. Come together right now. Over me. Okay, I never said I could sing. Boy, these ammo cans are taking way too much time. But one of the things you have to identify is there are certain things on certain models that will attract the majority of the attention of onlookers. And what that usually is, are things that are important to that model or have the highest contrast. And that has the highest contrast on this model. So when you put this model on the table, and somebody looks at it, they're going to notice any imperfections with that ammo can. So take a few extra seconds just to correct any mistakes or whatever. Also, if it's important, like on the machine gunner, people will probably look at the machine gun. But probably not. The Panzerfaust, they're going to look at that because it's got the highest contrast. Done. Last one, then we can stop this whole golden ochre thing. I tried putting this golden ochre on the inside of that church I built, but it didn't look good. It didn't cover inside the church either. I had a lot of these lines on the inside of the church. If you paint this golden ochre on top of a gray color, or even a white color, you will get great coverage. It won't have any streaks at all. So I guess I could have went in and painted the ammo boxes gray first and then went back over with gold. But that's not me. I don't do that. I make it work. Okay, we are getting down to the gritty. I think we're going to make the big jump. We're going to make the big jump to the camo. We're going to camo. Okay, so the first step of the camo is khaki. Okay, I'm using khaki to coat for all the camo. This is the base coat of the khaki. This is going to be 99% of these models are going to have khaki on them. Let me back up. Every single model will have some khaki on them. Why? Because I'm using khaki as well for the gaiters. And every single model has some form of gaiter. Either it's the bottom of the pants or it's a leather strap that went around the boots. So either way, everybody's got a gaiter. And then a lot of them have helmet covers, base coat. A lot of them have smocks. Or not smocks. I didn't paint any of the smocks camouflage. I painted them all field gray. But the shelter halves, the Zeltbond shelter halves, khaki. Okay, so I'm shaking this up. While I'm doing that, I'm reading. See you, Digger, if you haven't already left. All right, he's going to go play some XCOM. Which I'm kind of jonesing to play some XCOM myself, but I got to get these guys done. Actually, I don't have to get these guys done now that I've decided that I'm going to switch to 28s. I can, because I was getting these done so that I could sell them. And if I don't sell them, if I hold on to them, then I don't need to worry about it. Put a few drops of paint in my little reservoir. Put a drop or two of water. And then we stir. Stir, not shaken. Yep, this looks too thin. It's almost like... Yeah, that's too thin. I'm going to have to add some more khaki. The khaki didn't get mixed up or stirred up when I was shaking it. So I've got this tool that I used. I've got to find it. I got this tool that I used to stir up my Vallejo paints that tend to separate. So I open up the bottle, right? And then I got this thing right here. It's a paper clip. And then it's the largest paper clip I could find that would fit barely down inside there, okay? So it'll actually go in there, but it's really tight. I deliberately put a curve to it so that when it goes in, it curves into the corners of the bottle. And what do? Something simple. I just twist, knowing that that bar is on the inside, and I'm kind of trying to get that bar to go into all the corners. I'm trying to stir this thing up. I'm trying to break up any paint that might be congealing together down inside this bottle. Okay, there we go. Now we're down inside. Now we're all up in the business. Okay, so now I can peel it out. And because it's so tight, there's almost no paint on the on the tool
pip clip.
Okay, but that just breaks up the paint on the inside. It still needs to be stirred or mixed, unfortunately. My paint's... See how it's right there, separating? I added water to it, and it was already too thin. There was no paint. It was just probably the liquid that's inside. So I got to shake this up and get this ready to paint. And I'm going to add it straight to that. It's because that's already got a little bit of water. I just got to make sure it's thick enough. So just bear with me. I've got some coffee here. Let me go ahead and drink that so my hand shakes a little bit more. I'm going to reiterate this. If you ever watch anybody painting on YouTube, you will see that they will edit out things like what I'm doing right now, shaking bottles and stuff like that. They edit all that out. They also only paint one or two models. And they only show painting those one or two models. So what happens is, the videos only take like 15 minutes. Because they edit out, they don't talk, well they do talk, but they don't talk about, you know, just bullshit and talk about dice like we did earlier, or they don't do any of that, right? It just goes straight to the point. Some people like that. And that's the kind of video I was going to make for this. But then I sat down and I said, you know what, I'm just going to do it live. Hell, we'll do it live. Okay, so let's see if I get any real paint out now. I still don't know if I got any real paint. It was still kind of runny. You know? Wish me luck. I'm going to stir this. I could have almost just used it straight without adding any water. I add the water to spread it out, to thin it out, to make the paint last longer and stuff like that. Because Vallejo paint usually is extremely high pigment value. You know what? I wonder if Folk Art ever has a khaki. I'm going to have to check on that. Okay, so we are doing the tunics and the camouflage helmets, and the gaiters, and everything else. Okay, so here we go. Boom. Notice a big contrast between his helmet and his field gray. That's okay. Now this was just one of the loose helmets on the sprue. I just cut it out and glued it to his back. Because I thought the officers, well, they're not really an officer, he's an NCO. He should have a helmet as well as his troops. And he's not just going to throw it on the ground and run off with a soft cap. He's going to keep it. You probably have to pay for that. No. Nice. Now I need to do the spot on his boots that's between the pants and the boot itself. Now let's see if I can see in there. The lighting is not in exactly the right spot. I didn't move my second light over here. Just like that. Okay, so I've got enough 15 millimeter figures to go on for days and days and days. I am selling those. I'm getting out of the whole 15 millimeter market of World War II decided. There's a lot of people out there playing Flames of War in 15mm. They're probably going to be excited about those models. I hope they are. I want somebody to be able to benefit from my painting. Okay. Okay, helmets and gaiters. Okay, now he's on this model's got it as part of his pants. But that's okay. Hands are braced down onto the table, so give support so that my paintbrush and the model doesn't like rock around, move around all over the place. Because if it does, then you get double the wiggle, and you don't want any wiggle, right? Or what do they call it? Shaking. You don't want any shaking. Get the idea. Alright, so let me just go ahead and finish these guys up. Okay, he's got a camouflage helmet also. Pretty much they all do. I deliberately picked out the ones with the camo covers. But I also picked out the ones with the no camo covers. And then there was this one that looked like it actually had physical camouflage on it. I deliberately did not put that on any of my guys. Now, maybe one or two. Because I wanted to paint the camouflage and not have like bushes sticking out of their helmet. This looks like it's a great color for the Africa Corps as well. Knowing that I'm going to be painting some Africa Corps at some point. This khaki looks like it'd be great. For everything for Africa Corps. Tanks and infantry and everything. Okay, now this guy's got a smock, so it's going to be a second while I paint all that as well. Also, I'm speaking about my fellow painters. I've seen some painters out there, some really good ones, that when they're talking about their painting, first of all, they're not talking and painting at the same time. They paint, they film their painting, and then they go back and edit it. And in the editing process, they talk and tell you what they're doing. But not only that, they take the film and they speed it up. I've noticed that. Nothing wrong with that. It's great for what they're doing, but that's just not what I want to do. I want you to get the full experience, because you kind of lose something on the process when it's going fast and they're not talking and painting at the same time. Because it's hard. It's hard to paint and talk at the same time. Same thing with computer gaming. It's hard to talk and play a computer game at the same time. Or at least for me. Another time, another thing, if you've got a color like this khaki, right, and the model you're painting has, it can be any color. When the same color is touching itself, but you want to differentiate like a flap in the poncho or something, where they separate, where one flap is on top of another flap. You can do the black lining technique as well. You can paint one flap and leave a gap between the next flap, and that way that little black line will enhance where or what, I should say, where that flap is. Kind of brings your eyes down to it and you can see the transition between them, but even if they're the same color. It's just a technique. I'm going to be real with you. I'm not worried about all that. Because I'm hoping that the dip will bring all that out. And I know it will. Now I'm covering the ammo pouches that are supposed to be black or extremely dark brown. I'm covering those because I'm going to go back over them almost the very last step. And I'm going to highlight them with some pinpoint painting because the straps are really small. Yeah, don't put your model down until you give it a 360. Just now, I thought I had finished painting this guy. I turned him and I said, oh my gosh, I missed that whole side. It's better to do it now while you got the model out ready to paint and not down the road once the paint dries and everything, and you go, oh man, I forgot to paint the guy's left side. Then you got to go back in and paint the whole left side again. When you could have hit it up when you had the model out. Okay, so he's got his helmet, he's got his camouflage schmack, right? And that's only one of three colors that go on the camouflage. We're going to go ahead and what are we going to do? We're going to put him down without getting paint in my coffee. Okay. 99% of these guys only have helmets and gaiters that need to be khaki. Now what I'm thinking about doing is jumping to a couple of other steps just so that you can see all the different steps. But then I would personally have to go back and finish these models. But guess what? It's okay. Again, I said I'm not in a rush. I think that's what I'm going to do. I think I'm going to paint probably about 12 of them just to get a good selection. And then we'll jump to the next step. So we're not going to do all 30 of them to completion on the video. Because I want to hurry up and get to the dip process, because that's a that is the step that has to sit overnight and dry. The reason why it has to sit overnight is because it's a polyurethane stain, like a wood stain, but polyurethane. And when it goes on, it's kind of like oil-based and stuff, and it sits there, it sits on the model and drips down, and you got to put some wax paper down or your model, your table's going to be all polyurethane and stuff. So that process, the drying process, takes at least 12 hours, if not longer. And then once I dip those guys, or these guys, or whichever guys I'm doing, be these guys, the ones I'm putting the gaiters on and stuff, then I can get off camera and then just paint the rest and then dip the rest. You know what I mean? And they'll still be caught up to where I was at, because when I go to sleep, I'll come back and then all the dip will be dry. It's just that you don't need to sit here and watch me paint 30 models. Two or three or 12 should be enough. You would think. So that's what we're going to do. Because my guess is, hey, there's a grenade on his belt. There is a there's a theory of mine that not everybody stays for the entire video. Some people come in, they sit, they watch a minute or two, they get enthralled and they watch for 30 minutes while they're waiting for their dinner to finish cooking or something like that. And then they go off and eat their dinner. Or they log in, they say, oh man, there's this guy painting some German Grenadiers. Let me go check that out. They come over to the stream, they look and they say, oh, there's Mr. Everything and he's painting. Cool, man, that's really cool. All right, see ya. And they don't hang out, you know. But that's okay. Because, you know, not everybody has the time to sit and watch me paint for 2 to 3 hours.
And I fully understand that. But I'm doing this live just so that people can see exactly how long it takes to do this. Or it takes me to do this. But actually, I think this is an inaccurate estimate. Because with me talking and with me having to deal with the stream and everything, I think it actually takes me longer than it would if I wasn't streaming. So just take that into mind too. So if I ever get any more of these, and I'll be able to assemble them a lot faster, because I'll know where all the parts go and what the pieces look like and all that. Because the second time around, I'll know what I want to put them, how I want to put them together and stuff. So that should go faster as well. I would think. I mean, I don't know. I was also thinking about maybe doing a painting models on commission. So if somebody said, hey, could you paint me a group of like 20 Grenadiers or something? I would say, sure, and this is how much it would be, and send me the models. Or if you want me to buy the models and then paint them, I can do that as well. You would just have to pay me ahead of time, which you're going to have to do anyway, because I'm not going to do a painting job for somebody unless they pay me first, up front. Okay, it's gator time. Okay. Yeah, but if somebody wanted me to buy a model and paint it for them, or a group of models, I would do that. I don't have a problem with that. We just have to wait for the order to come in, and you know, and then I would have to paint it and then ship it back to them or something. Okay, I'm going to switch positions just because I want to do these 9. Next color, and we'll get these 9 really fixed up, painted. Okay. Some people are wearing their ponchos. He's actually got it rolled up on his back.
So that will have to be camouflaged as well. Okay, this guy's kneeling, so his leg is in a weird position. It's hard for me to kind of see the gator. Because this light is not behind me, it's off to the side. So when I'm looking at stuff, a lot of times there's a shadow. And it's hard for me to see everything. Okay. I mean, these guys look good just like that. And there are units that had the ponchos that were just a solid color. Yeah. There were units that had the solid color. But that's not going to be these guys. Even though I could, like, make one squad with a solid color and one squad with a red or brown camouflage, and then another squad with like a green camouflage, and that way you would know what squads are what. But personally, for my personal army, I don't think I want to do that, because I want to be able to mix and match my squads. Like, I want to take, if I want to have an 8-man squad, I want to have an 8-man squad. Or if I want to have 2 5-man squads, or if maybe I want to have 1 10-man squad. You know what I mean? So if you paint it to the point where it can only go one way, then you're hurting yourself. Because remember back when I was saying I like to run those scenarios, and you never know what kind of troops you have available in those scenarios. You just got to go with it, right? Okay. Okay, so that's khaki. Okay, and that's the base coat of the camouflage. The other two colors of the camouflage actually don't go on before the dip. They go on after the dip. So I'm going to hold off on those. Yeah, we'll leave that over there. But that's brass. We're not going to talk about that. Yeah, the blotches are the two that are going to be after the dip. So we'll put those over there. Now we're going to do some of the wood on the just these 9 guys, but the wood on the rifles is going to be flat earth. Okay, flat earth. Not just the rifles, now that I'm looking. The flat earth is also going to be the entrenching tool handle. It's also going to be... I think that's it. Entrenching tool handle and the rifle wood. Let's find out. Let's do this. All right. Now, some of these guys have MP40. Well, guess what? He's got a roll. He's got a bedroll. Okay, I got to go with the khaki. Sorry. Poncho is rolled up on his back, so there will be some camouflage on that, as well as the helmet. Glad I caught that, see? CCC. So I gotta double check them. Gotta double check them miniatures. Yeah, but there's no real wood on this guy. He doesn't even have an entrenching tool or anything, so we'll just set him off to the side. Boop. Go back to this guy. This guy does have an entrenching tool. Okay. But he doesn't have wood on his rifle because he's also got an MP40. Now, I only paint the wood, not the, at the top of the entrenching tool, there's like a little, it's in like a little case. I leave that black. That can stay black. And so that's all you're getting out of it, just that wooden pole. Okay. Man, these models, I'm stoked, man. These models look good. Okay, the bayonet or the knife. I think I'm gonna paint the bottom portion of the knife this brown. Okay, I'm also gonna paint the wood on this PPSH. I probably could have painted it a different color of wood just to make it stand out differently than all the other wood. Because, you know, it's Russian wood. It should be red wood, right? No, I'm kidding. I'm just playing. Yeah, that's all the wood on the PPSH. Everything else is like metal. Yikes. Fingers sticking. Okay, now this is the STG-44. So the only wood part is the stock. And I don't paint it 100% because I want some black lining. A little bit of black lining. And I'm trying to remember what else on the... I don't think there is anything else. I think that's all that is wood on the STG-44. I'm glad I know my rifles. Especially my World War II German ones. Got a bayonet. Or a trench knife, actually, is probably what it's called. I think it is a trench knife. Oh, you know what? I gave this guy two of them. Ha ha! He's got two trench knives. Okay, so that was a mess up on my part when I glued him together. Okay, but that's fine. He's got two of them. He's good in close combat. Okay, this guy's got a rifle stock right there. And he's got an entrenching tool. Okay. No knife. Because the entrenching tool sticks out the way it does, you got to make sure you get the inside of the wood as well, because you got to get 360 on that. Okay, that doesn't look good. From the distance, I was like, man, the top of that wood is too much black. You want some black, but you don't want too much black. That's what she said. Okay. Again, the entrenching tool, leaving the blade and the container black. Going with the stock. Now this guy's stock is kind of under his arm, and when I painted the flesh, I got it on the rifle. So you're going to have to make sure you hit that spot with brown just to cover the flesh. But the rest of it can just be squared away. Done. Okay, maybe I shouldn't have grabbed that with my finger, but that's okay. How else would you grab it? This one's also tucked under his arm. He's got to be careful about where you're painting. And he has an entrenching tool. And a bayonet. Okay. Or a trench knife. I'm not really sure what I should call it. Because I don't think it is a bayonet. I think it's just a knife, combat knife. Sweet. Now, dipping is definitely a major step. It's a big, huge undertaking. I say that because it's an oil base and you got to have thinner, and I actually use acetone to clean my brushes because it's not a water cleanup kind of thing. There are washes, right? But those are acrylics, and that's fine. But the whole purpose behind dipping is to do two steps in one. Otherwise, you just wash your models. You don't need to dip. But if you're going to do the two steps in one, one of the steps is the wash, like that you normally would do. And then the other step is sealing the model with a polyurethane. And that's where the mess comes in, because the polyurethane is oil-based, and you need to be able to clean your brush with some kind of thinner, paint thinner, acetone, mineral spirits, something. But I've got a whole like half gallon of acetone, so that's what I'll be using. That's what I have been using. That's why I got it like 20 years ago. No, I'm kidding. I think I got it like 2 years ago, though. I think I brought it from the old house, actually. See, I don't want to dip. I really don't want to dip until everybody's ready to be dipped. Because I don't want to dip, clean the brush, stop the video, paint everybody else, and then go back and dip again. So you know what I'm going to do? Finish them. And then we'll dip. Damn. Okay, so what does that mean? That means I need to do the khaki while I'm thinking about it. So no shortcuts. Dang it, I was going to shortcut this bitch. Okay, nobody's watching. Back to khaki. And I've already got the paint mixed up and everything right here, so why don't I just use it since I've got it out? No waste. Okay, so I'm going to be silent just for a few minutes while I finish up these models, and then we'll go to dipping. So, if you want to go take a break, relax, come back in about 15 minutes, and I should be ready to dip. If you're watching this video later on YouTube and not live, just go ahead and fast forward about 15 minutes. And you should see me dipping. Maybe. Maybe you'll see me dipping. Okay. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to spread these guys out just a little bit because they're a little bit too tight over here. I'm having a hard time getting to my models. Down the line. Okay. Not done. Dang. I promised myself I was going to finish these tonight far enough to dip. So I'm going to make sure I do that. Wasn't too bad. Yeah, this is not a painting tutorial video. This is just a painting live stream where you can come out and watch a professional painter paint some miniatures. Now, why do I call myself a professional? What's the definition of professional? Someone who gets paid to do what he does. Right? That's what professional means. So, if I ever get paid, or if I ever have been paid, which I have, to paint models, then I'm a professional painter. Or you might call it a pro painter. An amateur painter is a painter who doesn't get paid for it. It has nothing to do with skill level. It has to do with the monies. Okay, good. Just making sure I painted those gators.